So you're trying to figure out what in the world's going on with mortgage rates. When will they possibly be coming down? That's what we're going to talk about. My name is Dan Frey. I do this report every day to inform you guys, what's the economics behind housing? We really don't know what's going on with housing prices because it's way too local for you guys. Because if you're out in San Diego, there's probably going to be a pullback. If you're in here in Illinois, we're actually seeing a nice little market rally. So home prices are really fluctuating and so are interest rates. But what my goal here is to educate you on why interest rates are where they are and what the expectations are for the future. And what I mean by the future is I'm talking 3, 6, 8 months, maybe a year down the road. That's what we're going to talk about today. So these are the rates where they are today. We're going to get to that in a minute. What I want to go over with you guys is what's the economic data that's coming in that's really playing, I guess, at this point, havoc on the markets. So right now we're seeing 10-year yields climb as investors wait for the Federal Reserve's comments. So what's going on in the markets right now? Just so you guys understand, I did a lot of research over the weekend and I've been trying to drill in what's going on with mortgage rates and specifically the whys behind it. Because there's a disconnect right now. There's a premium disconnect when it comes to long-term rates and short-term rates. So you're going to need maybe an economics degree to follow this one, but at the end of this, I'll kind of put it in a bow for you so you figure out, okay, Dan, I get it. So let's get over to it. 10-year treasuries are climbing. What's going on behind the scenes? So let's get over to some of the markets. Right now, we see the Dow Jones, it's up, NASDAQ's up, S&P's up, and everything else. Just to let you guys know, guys, back in 2008 when the world was imploding and, you know, housing market crashed and everything else crashed, we also had the stock market crashing about 30 or 40% at that time. We haven't seen that. I'm expecting a little pullback in the markets because I think the stock markets and equities are a little inflated in values on the PEs. But that's a talk for another time. What we want to talk about is the economic data coming in, and then I'm going to drive in and drill down why mortgage rates are doing what they're doing because there's a disconnect in the term premium when it comes to bond yields. So don't turn the dial. I'm going to educate you guys today. So the first thing we want to do is let's go through the economic calendar for the week to see, is there anything coming up this week that might play havoc in the market? Well, the answer to that, unfortunately, is yes, like normal. So what we come in is there's no economic news today, which is fantastic, but you're going to see the markets are kind of, the bond market's disconnected with the stock market. Stock market's up, bonds are down, and bonds are considerably down right now, and I'll explain it to you. But existing home sales, here's what's coming in this week. Existing home sales on Tuesday. Then on Wednesday, we have building permits, new home sales, crude oil inventories. Not a lot to digest in this section right here. But then we start getting to Thursday. Now, this is kind of in the wheelhouse of the Federal Reserve. Why do I say that? Well, the Federal Reserve monitors two things. They have two mandates. One is inflation, expectations of rates, you know, of prices going up or down. And then the other is the jobs market. They thrive for full employment. They're not thriving for full employment right now because they want the market to pay pretty much condense or start to flatten down or start to reduce because they want the numbers, the inflation numbers to really start coming down. So on Thursday, you're going to have core durable goods orders and the initial jobless claims. Again, that jobless claims part is the Federal Reserve. And then on Friday, we have Federal Chairman Powell speaking. Now, this always makes the hair on the back of my neck stand up because I don't know what he's going to say. He might just say one word that's a little off kilter. Mainstream media might take this information and run one narrative. Then it takes a couple days for basically the markets to subside or adjust to those numbers. But the one thing I want to talk about today, since there's really no data out there, is why rates are so high. Well, what happens is when we try to analyze where mortgage rates are going, let's get over to this. We follow something called the R star. It's basically where interest rates should be in a normal market, the natural rate, you know, basically interest rate. So let's get over to this, and I want to educate you guys on something. The R star rate right now is about 1.25%. Okay, so I want you to digest that 1.25%. Okay, that gives us basically our starting point to where rates should be. We then take that R rate and we add in to that what the expectations by the Fed are on inflation. Well, the Federal Reserve wants us to get to 2.5%, and we're on our way there. We'll get there eventually. But right now, we're about 3 or 3.25%. Let's see what the rates are today. Right now, we have inflation measures on July of 2023 at 3.25. Okay, so how we figure this out is how we want to figure out, you know, is there a premium for specific rates, you know, on the short end or the long end. What I mean by that is, let's go over to this right here. This might explain this a little bit better for you. We go over to this market right here. Here's where rates are in general. You see the two-year treasury note, it's 4.93. And then you go to the 30-year treasury note, it's 4.3. Well, there's something called a term premium that's should be built into these things. Meaning, the longer the term duration out, the longer in the future out, as an investor, you want higher returns. So for example, there's an anomaly right now. Two-year rates are higher than 30-year rates. Okay, that's why adjustable rate mortgages are higher than 30-year fixed. Okay, but this is going to give investors, especially you out there, I'm expecting a pullback in the S&P of about 5-6%. Why? Well, the PE ratios should be about 15-18%. Right now they're at 20%. So I'm expecting a pullback in the stock market. Okay, but what a lot of people are doing, they're moving their money out of banks. You see all these videos and you, mainstream media telling you about there's a run on the banks. People are pulling their money out of the banks. Well, yeah, what they're doing is they're taking their money out of their savings and checking accounts because it's earning 0.00 nothing, and they can put it in a two-year treasury at a yield at 5%. So then you look down through it, it's like you would think to yourself, okay, well, if I do a two-year at 5%, would a three-year be 5.5%? Would a 10-year be 8%? Well, no, look at it on the screen. The 2 years at 4.9, and if I want to invest that money out for 30 years, I want a term premium because I'm locking up my money longer, I should get a higher rate. It's actually lower. So there's a disconnect. The term premium right now is really, really, really high on the short end. Why? Because investors are piling in to short-term investments and they're pulling out of long-term investments. That's why we're seeing mortgage rates spiking to the highest levels we've seen in decades and decades and decades. Think about it this way. Okay, as an investor, I take my money and I can buy bonds. And in this case, we're stocks, okay? So people are electing to buy bonds right now because the stock market's getting a little bit frothy. So they look at the yields and they say, okay, I can buy a two-year treasury at a 5%, or I can lock up my money for basically ever and get 4%. What am I gonna do? I'm gonna pile into the short-term rates, okay? So people are putting all their monies, their money in this basket of a two-year treasury. So people have no appetite for the 30 years. So you're seeing a complete disconnect in the term premiums. Where should rates be? Well, if we take this tips, or we take this, the measurements right here, we take the R star number, and right now we're seeing that number at about 1.25, okay? Then we add back in, like I said before, the inflation numbers at 3.25. That should put long-term maturities about 4.5%, okay? 4.5% on the long-term maturities. You see through here, where are they? 4.3. You can't, on the short term, they're higher than the 4.5. So there's too much of a premium right now built into the short term rates. I'm expecting about a 1.75 deviation or a 1.75 reduction in rates. So my expectations long term, this year, you know, this time next year, rates are going to be about 1.5% lower than where we are today. So what's the trajectory? What's the path of getting us there? Unfortunately, all the news that we see on a daily basis revolves around this. The yields, all we do is sit on the sidelines waiting for the Federal Reserve to talk to tell us when rates are going to start coming down. So that's the one piece of the puzzle that really intrigues me. So let's talk now on housing with this. So why did so many people during the pandemic buy houses? Okay, one, they were staying there in their homes. They were going crazy because the walls were caving in on them because of they couldn't basically leave the house. So a lot of people bought properties. Plus, the Federal Reserve basically had interest rates at net zero. So we had mortgage rates. I got a mortgage on my house on a 30-year term at 2.5%. What are they today? Well, if you go over into Mortgage News Daily, 7.375. My rate is almost 5% lower than where rates are today. So will this last forever? No. The reason why people bought homes during the pandemic was basically the Federal Reserve was giving money away. Now they're really retractive. They've really put a premium on interest rates in the tune of, you know, I see mortgage rates should be about 6%. between 5.5% and 6%. We will get there. This will give a lot of people opportunities that are buying today because maybe you have to buy today, you're relocating, you don't want to rent anymore. We have horror stories every day of people renting and they just get booted out of the house. We're selling the house, we're no longer going to rent it, you know, and so forth. And they're jacking up the rents for people. That might not be you. You might just say, Dan, I'd love to buy a house. How do I get there? So my thought is, you know, is today a perfect time to buy in your situation? I don't know that. But my thought is, if you look at this as a long-term venue, you know, when you're buying to the stock market, you don't buy today and then if your stock goes up a dollar, you don't go in tomorrow and sell. I'm hoping you're not going to do that with real estate. Real estate should have at least a 5 to 10 year time frame. No, you don't know what's going to happen 10 years from now. But if there's any expectations you might have to move within 3 years, please don't buy a house. Okay, but if you're looking to buy and stay in that property for 5, 6, 7 years, you're probably going to have 1, maybe 2 opportunities during that whole time to refinance to get a much better rate. Now, a lot of you might say, Dan, yes, but the housing market's going to crash. Well, that narrative's been here for the last 3 years, I want to say. We see some markets on the West Coast that are down about 6%, maybe 10% from the peak. Okay, well, they saw 40% rallies during 2 year time frame. So to give back 10%, okay, if I'm a trader or I'm an investor, I'm okay with that. But we see a huge portion of the market, over 50%, almost 60% of the market, that has not seen a retraction in prices. So yes, you have areas such as California, Southern California, parts of Nevada, Arizona, Texas possibly, the Austin area, Idaho, which saw a rambunctious appreciation during the pandemic, which I still can't figure that one out why, and they're coming back down. But you have the Midwest and many parts of the East Coast that are basically steady, and the curve is usually appreciation on housing on average equates out to about a 4 to 4.5 increase every year in housing. We're seeing that continuation through the Midwest and through the East Coast. So if you're in there at those areas, you should be okay and you should have basically points of or the ability next year to refinance. And let's say rates today are 7.5%, you know, if rates and you can afford it, God bless you. And then what happens next year when and if rates come down to 5.5%, 6%, you can refinance and probably reduce your payment a couple $100. Can you do that if you're renting? No. So let's get over to where we have the rates that are going today. So based on all this information that I gave you today, which really there's no economic news coming out, what's the markets doing? Well, if we go over to this, and the markets aren't doing very well at all, and I can't figure this out. Again, it's got to be a risk premium because there's no data out today, folks. You can see over here, there's the August housing starts inventory increase 0.9. That's nothing. We have significant fallings of whatever. There's no economic data that really should justify the market's pullback like we're seeing right now. So based on all this, what's going to go on with mortgage rates? Well, based on all this, we're probably going to see about an 1/8 increase in rates. So don't be surprised if rates go from 7.375 to maybe 7.5 today. Again, here's where rates are today. Well, I'll say this is where rates ended on Friday because banks haven't published yet today. So these are the top 6 products people get or use when they're buying or refinancing a house. If you want to check out these rates. But what this rate is right here, the analysis is, you might say, Dan, you quoted me a rate the other day and the rate was higher. Okay, well, let's go over the criteria that makes these rates right here. So to qualify for a 7.375 rate, you'd have to have 5 criterias. And this is a national average, and I'll explain that in a second. So what Mortgage News Daily does is they survey lenders all over the country and ask them this question. If you had a first-time home buyer that was buying a primary home and that house was a single-family home, those 3 things, and they have it a 740 credit score, and they're putting 20% down. Is that you? Those 5 criteria? Maybe not the 20% down, but you might have the other ones. Well, that's what most likely what your rate's going to be. So we're seeing rates gradually moving up from here today based on the economic data we have and what the bond market's doing. That's my report for today. So you see, today's rates, we're probably going to be teetering at 7.375 to 7.5. But my long-term duration, Q1 of next year, you know, we might have some stagnations. We might be in the high 6s and still maybe in the 7s. But then from there, the Federal Reserve is even telling us they plan on pivoting next year. And a lot of people are saying, no, they're not going to pivot. They're going to hold these rates up, you know, at these levels for the for the future. Sorry, I'm getting tongue-tied. Well, I'm going to disagree with that, because one of the things that we focus in on here is, let's go to it, is what the Federal Reserve actually tells us they're going to do. So if you go over to the CME Fed Watch tool, you're seeing that right on your screen here. What this does is it's telling us what's the probability that the Federal Reserve will change rates at the next meeting. If you go down through here, the probability right now is they're not going to change rates. They're not going to increase rates in September. But there's a thing called the dot plot. The dot plot basically tells us where the Federal Reserve wants the federal funds rate. Okay, so in 2023, they want the federal funds rate between 5.5 and 5.75. Today, we're teetering on 5.5. Okay, so we're 0.25% off of the peak on where the Federal Reserve wants rates. Okay, well, let's forecast out to 2024. What's the Fed members? Make sure you understand that. What are the Fed members telling us they're going to do? If you go over to here, most of the dots are coming in where? About 4.25 to 4.5. Okay, from 5.75. So what does that tell us? Well, that tells us, back to my analysis, rates should be about 1.5% lower in the future, 2024, than where we are today. So again, if you take the rates where we are today, right here at 7.375, you take 1.5 off of that, that brings us down to high fives, low sixes. That's my long-term expectations and the whys behind it all. So if you'd like to find out more about me and my team, how we can help you, I just changed up my website to give you a little bit more flair. Please visit us at therateupdate.com. Here's our website. How you get started? Well, how do you get started? The best thing to do, hit the apply now button. You're not going to apply for a mortgage. What you're going to do is you're going to schedule a consultation with me or one of my mortgage advisors. Let's click over to that. What's going to pop up is right here. This is our calendar. So what you're going to do, we are a part of Win the House You Love with Kyle Seagraves. He's a partner of ours. And what you're going to do is go in here and schedule a date and time at your convenience where you can have a consultation with me or one of my mortgage advisors to ask us any questions that you have in regards to home ownership. But if you'd like to give us a call, the best thing to do is you can reach us at 1-844-775-LOAN. That's 1-844-775-LOAN. Take care, guys. Thanks so much for watching. God bless. Have a fantastic day. Bye-bye.